I'm Van.
I'm Sori.
And this is for a very special individual in our village. This is for the wonderful, beautiful soul known as Amy Lee Forever.
Mm-hmm. And the song is being dedicated to Chris.
Shout out to the big homie.
She has a special message for you. It's, if you're having fun without her there, then you're going to be in trouble when she gets there. That is something I would say to you. So well.
Yes. You're both exactly the same in that regard.
I said that makes complete sense.
So this is Evanescence for the big homie Amy Lee. Not gonna talk about the normals, we're just gonna get into it. Let's go!
Okay, wait, go! Do you know the name of the song?
The name of the song is My Heart Is Broken.
Yep. Okay.
Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Let's go.
And
backstory to that situation,
yeah.
For our friend, but Here we go. First of all, Amy Lee, man.
Oh, my word. I love her as an artist.
Sonically, she's pretty much the same live. I mean, we were literally like 5 feet away from her in that, what do you call it?
At that show we went to,
we had the media passes and we were able to, you know, do it. So, it's one of those things where she can actually sing the exact same way live as she does on the recording, which is pretty crazy.
So I'm assuming that she's singing about her sister in this song.
Well, she had a sister that died, right?
Yeah. So I'm assuming that that's...
Yeah.
But the concept of being separated from someone that you really, really love is... I haven't gone through that where I had somebody that's been, you know, like my grandmother, I was at her house almost every single day, but nobody's surprised when an old person dies, you know? I mean, she was in her 80s, you know what I mean? Like, it wasn't like it was a surprise and there was a slow decline and, you know, but like to lose someone in their prime is absolutely, ugh.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it, when I think about it, it gives me this like feeling of claustrophobia. Like when I think about you know, with your mom and stuff, like I have to stop thinking about it because when I think about it, it's just too much. It's like, ugh.
Yeah, the first line is really interesting. I pulled away to face the pain.
I know.
Usually people pull away to...
To
avoid the pain. So, I thought that the...
What do you think she pulled away from?
The song title was, you know, pretty...
What do you think she pulled away from, though? Because that line doesn't even make any sense to me.
Well, I mean, she's got a lot of distractions, right?
Right.
I mean,
so you think she pulled away from...
She's Amy Lee. She's a rock star. There's millions of things that you could do to distract yourself so you don't have to deal with what's in front of you. I think all of us have those, you know.
Yeah.
People run into bad situations, a lot of standard coping mechanism is to just get busy.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of a very, very mature thing to say, I pulled away to face the pain. That's a really mature thing to say. The name of the song itself is very simplistic. My heart is broken.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, a lot of people have a hard time. You know, we were in the middle of changing the world around the time my mother died. Like, well, I was in the middle of that, foreign and domestic. And so, the people that I was working with here that you knew, I didn't tell them till like 3 or 4 months later. Like, they had no idea. Mm-hmm. I just kept it moving. Nobody had any idea. And my other group, to this moment, they still don't know.
Mm-hmm. Because... I think that... I thought it was a strange thing to do, like, because I would want people to know.
Right.
If I would... But at the same time, like, if you can avoid all of that, like, you know, because then everybody's going to be asking questions, they're going to be talking to you about it, they're going to say, how are you doing? And then, like, when somebody says... like a real heartfelt, like, how are you? Like, sometimes it can just pull you back. Like, I was just trying to push forward through today, you know?
Mm-hmm.
This line, when she said, I close my eyes and drift away over the fear that I will never find a way to heal my soul.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I always try to be genuine in these videos. Me personally, I don't believe I'll ever be the same person I was before my mother died and before my mother-in-law died. You know, I've progressively become more and more of a different person. So, you know, I do think like there's ways of healing. Like, one of the things that, you know, that I do is I purposely talk about my mom.
you know, like before I wouldn't talk about my mom at all. But you know, I've it's cool, you know, because we've got this channel. It's been viewed by millions of people or millions of times, and you know, I've got the solace that, you know, because it was hard for me being at my mom's funeral because my mother touched literally like thousands and probably tens of thousands of people, and there was like, you know, 12 of us at the funeral, and it was kind of, that was hard for me. So, you know, so being able to share my mom with the community has been important because, you know, it's a way of, in my opinion, getting the, well, I mean, yeah, getting the respect and the honor that she deserves, in my opinion. So, you know, but it's definitely, and you know, I do it in doses, in small doses, you know, like
facing
certain things, you know, I do that in small doses because I've come to realize, you kind of come to realize how much you can take and how much you, you know, you can't, depending on what other stuff is going on. But, you know, a lot of people in varying degrees of closeness to me have died. And I think it is different. Like, you know, I've had people that are important to me and they died, but it was one of those situations where you made a choice, you made a decision, you knew the risks when you got into it, and you know, that's the way, you know, people died in those circumstances, that's the way they want it to go. And everybody kind of had the same mentality, and so, you know, it's a little bit different, but again, it's one of those things where people aren't getting the credit that they deserve because, you know, the nature of the thing is like, you know, so that part is hard, but if you have a small group of people that know what they did and they're heroes to you, then you know that just has to be enough. And again, like it's like you said about your grandmother, like you kind of have the expectation when you're in your 80s and you're sick, you know, you've done your thing, but you know, and so there.
Well, I think that there's degree to me. I don't know. I haven't been in all the situations, but it seems to me that there's degrees. There's, you know, a person that dies way too young by, you know, something tragic that you didn't really see coming, and then, you know, then you have their suicide angle. There's so many different, like, to me, the hardest one. Like my father used to say, my father was in his early 20s. When my grandfather died. So his dad died when he was only like 24 years old. And now I'm like, wow, I can't imagine if my dad had died when I was 24. But so he said that it took like a year, like he didn't expect his father to die when he was that young, you know, he had a heart attack and that was it, you know. He didn't even get to say goodbye. So I think he had a heart attack at work too, that's like worse. Because they treated him like shit at that place. He worked at a shoe shop and they didn't, like, he asked for a raise and they gave him like a 2-cent raise or something like that, like something real insulting. He was a really hard worker and he wasn't going to go anywhere and they knew that, so they just took advantage of that. So there, you know, there's stuff like that, and my father said, like, it took a, he also lost his brother. And so when my uncle died, it was the same thing. Like, he got cancer and he died. So there was, like, my father had a lot of those losses. But then he said that it took a year because you had to go through all of the first Christmas without them, the first this without them.
Yeah.
You know? And then he said after the year, he said it got a little bit easier. But it seemed to me that he was saying basically the same thing. Like, it's not like you fully heal from... Because there's still a part of your heart that, like... is connected to them because we're eternal beings. So, you know, we're going to go on in another way and they went on in another way and we're going to reconnect up, inshallah. But I think that, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just hard.
That was so interesting. Sweet sleep, sweet sleep, my dark angel, deliver us from sorrow's hold. Now, I have a pretty good guess at what our friend Amy Lee, who the dark angel is for her, but for me, that line is about Jesus, and it's a very interesting concept to see Jesus as a dark angel, but there's very good biblical warrant to see Jesus as an angel, and that's a separate discussion. But an angel who comes in the darkness and doesn't necessarily illuminate everything, but sits with you in the darkness, I think is important for friendship, and that's who Jesus has been for me in a lot of my, pretty much all my losses. Uh-huh. And so, and you know, he's also been the bright angel that lights everything, but there's been times when he's showed up with some dark wings and sat with me, and that's been important. So that was a very interesting angle, you know.
Well, when you said it, I didn't think of that, you know, I just, you know, I thought of you like if I was separated from you, but,
I'm your dark angel. Ah, a melanin?
No, it was a
dark
double.
Angel?
It was a double for sure. So the, when you said Jesus, though, like, and, like, I immediately saw it from that angle, and the sleep sweet my dark angel was, like, those 3 days that he was in the grave.
Yeah.
And then he was resurrected. So, deliver us from sorrow's hold, because death had a hold on us, and then after his resurrection, it no longer did. So, I don't think that's where she was going
yeah.
with that.
Right, right.
But I really like that, the way that you, you know, obviously.
Well, yeah, I that's one of the things meaningful. I really, really love about Christianity is, like, the real world practicality. So like some people try to ease the sting of death by saying death is a part of life, and the Bible says no, death is not a part of life.
Right.
Death is an intruder. Death right. is an enemy. Mm-hmm. 1 Corinthians 15. And then it says we do not mourn as those who have no hope. But what that means is it doesn't say we don't mourn. It just right. says we mourn in hope.
Right.
And so I love that because it's very real world. I'm not going to walk around and pretend that death is some natural thing and accept it and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't accept that.
Yeah.
I don't accept that. But, and if we just all casually accepted it, we wouldn't write millions of songs about it, mm-hmm. about that type of separation. Like, all of us are made for relationships, and those relationships are massively significant. And you can say, we came up with the concept of an afterlife because it's so hard to accept the loss of those relationships. Or that's one universe you can live in. Or you can say the depth and gravity of our relationships indicate that there's something bigger than just this life. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you can be cynical and say, oh, that's just wishful thinking. Or you can say, that's the way it's supposed to be. So, for example, if a kid is in an orphanage and he's mourning because he doesn't know why he's mourning, you can immediately go, well, he's mourning because he's missing his mom and dad. Mm-hmm. And the fact that he's got this deep desire to have a parent indicates that he had a parent. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't go to the kid and say, well, the idea that you had a parent is just wishful thinking.
Right.
You would say, the reason you feel this way is because you were supposed to have a parent. Mm-hmm. And sure, to being a kid in an orphanage, if all you know is the orphanage, then yeah, a house, a loving home with mom and dad who love you is wishful thinking, but it's also real. Mm-hmm. And so that's the way I look at, you know, this whole situation about death is that, yeah, you can say, oh, that's just wishful thinking. But I say, no, it's us knowing how things were supposed to be. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to tell the kid that, you know, you should have a mom and dad in a loving home. You don't have to tell the kid that. The kid in his soul, in the inexplicable portions of his being, the kid knows that intuitively, and we know it intuitively. Mm-hmm. And it is unnatural to love to the degree that we love and then have that torn away. That's yeah. not natural. That's yeah. not the way that things should be. And, you know... You know, we were talking to one of the guys that we did his song review. And then he, you know, I'm being very general here because I'm going to respect brother. But, you know, he said, basically, you know, he lost a very important member. The person died in his arms, essentially. And then he saw our video that he requested like 4 hours later and all that. And we had a conversation and... he was kind enough to show me a picture of this person.
I'll
show you a couple of pictures, but and we were talking back and forth, and he had lost his crucifix or whatever in the pool, and this person jumped in the pool and was like swimming around looking for it, and he basically said, "I wasn't gonna stop until I found it for you." And then the next day he was gone, and I said, "We'll see him again, inshallah." He's like, "Yeah, we're gonna see him again, you know." And so, but that doesn't mean that you don't feel the loss now, you know. And that's what I love about it, is that balance between not accepting that these gigantic bonds that you have with a person are just, they're completely broken. Like, I'm glad that our faith doesn't say to accept that, but at the same time, accepting that when a person dies, you're gonna have to wait a long time to see them again, and and it's gonna hurt. And I love that. I love the real world aspect of it. I hate the whole pretentious stuff and deadening your emotions and, you know, detach yourself from, like, that's ridiculous. Like,
I saw this thing, like, my mom used to have this book that had like all these like quotes and proverbs and different things like that. I've always like been totally into quotes. I think that quotes are so fascinating to take something significant and put it in just a few words.
Uh-huh.
And like there was a picture of like a tree, and it was talking about how the human soul is like a tree, in that if you, you know, if you cut off one branch, even a very large branch on a tree, like, it will grow other branches, like, that life will go in other places.
Right.
And,
Oh, that's good. That's good.
And I think that's one of the reasons why I'm glad that God gives us, you know, there are all kinds of different types of relationships. Like, you know, there's romantic relationships, and then there's friendships, and there's, you know, and I think that the village has created a lot of different branches
yeah.
for people, and... You know, we've been able to love people and be loved by people, you know, even...
And quite frankly, it all circles around pain.
Uh-huh.
95 to 98% of metal music, whether you're a Rage Against the Machine type band and you're socially conscious, it's still pain.
Yeah.
Whether you're a Tool person and you're internally conscious of the soul, it's still talking about pain. Whether you're a raging person, like Korn, it's... All of us have been, that are part of this community, have been in, at the ground level, have been bonded around shared pain, and then the shared attempt of helping us heal each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's a beautiful thing. And again, it's one of those things where it's like just a real world aspect of Christianity, where you... And of course, not everybody, most of the villagers are not Christians, but where it's you're allowed to feel the full brunt of the pain, and you're not told to suppress it, and you're not told to avoid it and detach from it or whatever. Mm-hmm. You're told to feel it at its full weight, but feel it with an anchor beneath all of that, that there's hope, and that there's, you know...
Mm-hmm.
That there's a good future that that we all want, and that we want the good future because all of us are basically orphans, and that the way that the world currently is a giant orphanage, and it's not the way it's supposed to be. And you kind of run into brothers and sisters in the orphanage that we call the earth, but that you know, our big brother came down to get us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like me and my little brother were massive rivals back in the day. And I just remember one time we were bike riding, and we had gone to this place, we were in Florida at the time, we had gone to this place that we'd never went to before, and I got separated from my little brother, and I couldn't find him. And I started crying because I couldn't find him. And I just remember saying, like, "I'm not going home without my brother." Now, me and him were at war with each other. Like, mm-hmm. Well, he wasn't at war with me, but I was always at war with him.
Mm-hmm.
And I just remember I was like, started to get a little bit of anxiety and all that. And I started crying. And like, right as I was like really starting to he came around the thing, and I was like, what were you doing?
That sorrow to anger real quick.
Yeah, and I was like, just right in front of me so I could see you. You know what I mean? I was like 2 minutes from leaving. Which is a complete lie. It was one of the few times I prayed, and God was like, you do love your brother.
Hmm? See?
I was like, stay in front of me and stay on the side.
How old were you?
I was 9, 10.
How old do you think he was?
11. He was, I don't know, 8, 9 or something like that. But, you know, Jamie was like, he was, you know.
Was he taller than you back then?
No. And I used to think he was helpless because he never wanted to fight. Mm-hmm. You know, like me and Junior would fight all the time. And he that wasn't his thing.
Yeah.
You know, like he never wanted to fight, you know, so. So, oh yeah, but that's kind of that's always been one of the pictures of Jesus to me, like that. Mm-hmm. God has always given me that picture, like that's mm-hmm. why he said, like, you know, was it Matthew, he said, I have a baptism undergo, and he basically said, I am anxious until it's fulfilled, because mm-hmm. he knew that he wasn't going to be able to, you know, repatriate the orphanage until he did that. Mm-hmm. And so he's like, I'm not coming home until every single one of them mm-hmm. are coming with me. That's a very powerful image to me.
Yeah. Yeah, I would agree with that.
But yeah, shout out to Amy Lee Forever. Obviously, for me anyway, this is getting a silent count. This is a pretty heavy situation. And, you know, I think there's a time for everything under the sun, and you know, it's not necessarily bad sometimes to have a sad moment or to have a reflective moment. I think there's too many cultures that are just looking at pain and sorrow as a bad thing. Mm-hmm. Like, there's an entire book in the Bible called Lamentations. Like, it's important to lament. Mm-hmm. It's important. You know, not all the time, not every day, but it's important to set aside some time and lament, and do it in chunks. Mm-hmm. You know, in Old Testament Israel, they used to do it for, you know, it was like a week or something like that. Well, Moses, they did it for an entire 40-day span, you know, so that's important. So, there you go.
It's not a silent count for me. It's an 11. It just, to me, was just so well done. I loved the way that her voice sounded. I loved the way it went, just musically, the sound of it. There was nothing I didn't like about it. And I think that this is an important song when you have lost somebody that you can kind of relate to, because I think that relatability is very important. Mm-hmm. And obviously, like, I think that, you know, I'll pray for anybody who's in this situation, I would pray for their healing, so that way they don't always stay stuck in this song. But I think that this is just, I don't know, just the way that she did it was just really, really good. And she conveyed her pain well, I thought. Some of the times when she was, like, singing in the music video, the way that she would, like,
did that cry. Yeah, I hope the music video doesn't get
blocked. If it does, you really should watch it. But anyway, so it was just really, really well done. But this day is not all sad. It is Amy Lee's birthday.
Right.
So, you were born this day, and we're very, very happy you were born. Not just because you've been a giant help to us, but just every single person brings such a significant and interesting piece to this world. And so we are lucky to have been able to meet you.
And she is the only villager with which we've gotten a victory royale with at Fortnite.
Right.
So, DJ, let's go, buddy. But that's very, very important, because the last game me and you played, you failed miserably. So, shout out to Amy Lee Forever.
So, let us know if there's anything from our merch shop that you're interested in.
Yeah, we keep trying to give her stuff, and she doesn't take anything. So.
Well, she wanted this review, though.
Yeah, there you go.
So, we're going to sing happy birthday to you now.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Amy Lee Forever. But we know your real name, but we're not going to say it on TV. Happy birthday to you. And what is she getting? A new car.
Oh, I wish we could give you a new car.
Get out.
Sorry, out.
Go.